Hello friends, how are you all? I hope I found you all in the good health and you all are doing well. Now my topic is aspect of cell culture. Before starting my topic, I want you all to subscribe my channel, like, share, comment. If you want to suggest me any topic, please comment in my comment box. Now let's get started. So what do you all mean by cell culture? Cell culture is basically involves the in vitro maintenance and propagation of cells in a suitable nutrient media. So we can say that culturing is a process of growing cells artificially. Cell culture in recent time have become an indispensable technology in various branches of life science like immunology, like cell tissue engineering technologies, and also in the recombinant DNA technologies. For example, monoclonal antibodies can be produced by cell culture and it can be used in diagnostic and treatment purpose. It can be used as host cells in recombinant DNA technology. So there are various kind of application of cell culture techniques. So terminology in cell culture. First of all, historical background. It was in 1907. Ross Harrison first developed a frog tissue culture technique. He chose frog because of its regeneration capacity in tissue of frog. In 1940s, trichembryo tissue became a favorite for culture technique. Interest in culturing in human tissues started in 1950 after it was demonstrated that the human tumor cells could give rise to the continuous cells line. Second, terminology in cell culture. Actually, tissue culture is used to include both the organ culture and the cell culture. Organ culture is the culture of the native tissue, that is the undisaggregated tissue, while in the cell culture, it is a culture of dispersed or disaggregated cells. Histotypic culture is the culturing of the cells so that the re-aggregation can take place and the tissue-like structure will form that represents histotypic culture. Organotypic culture is a culture of various type of recombination of different type of cells to form a more defined organ or tissue. Primary culture, the culture produced the freshly isolated cells or tissue taken from an organism is the primary culture. Cell line, cell line is a subculturing of the primary culture to give rise to the cell lines. So importance of growth medium. Now when we think about the cell culture, the things which require for a typical cell culture is first of all, there are many things, a number of things required in the culture of the cell, in the cell culture. So first, like infrastructure for sterile and pure clean area, and like glass vessel, glassware vessels, or glassware vessels, equipments, and aseptic condition, sterilization, and the growth medium. So growth medium is important for proliferation of cells, and aseptic condition should be maintained throughout the culture. The selection of appropriate growth medium for the in vitro cultivation of the cells is very essential step. So for culturing these cells in vitro, it is expected that they should be provided with a component similar to those present in the blood. Why so blood? This is because, as we know, that in the mammalian cells, blood, the nutrients, cells receive the nutrients from this blood circulation. So we have to provide the component similar to those present in blood so that they can be proliferate. So proliferation take place with the help of various type of nutrients like amino acids, vitamins, etc., which we will discuss in later slides. Then the cell expansion. As we have discussed earlier, that the cell expansion, proliferation take place with the help of the culture media. So culture media is expected to possess certain physicochemical properties, that is the pH, O2, CO2, buffering, osmolarity, viscosity, etc. As we know that the pH and temperature is very important to support the growth, as they are involved in, as they provide the suitable enzymatic conditions so that the enzymatic reaction take place at a suitable or optimum temperature and pH. O2 is also important in the case of aerobic cell culture. but extra of O2 means if O2 extra O2 can cause the toxicity. So sometime O2 scavengers can be used, like mercaptan ethanol, etc. CO2, as we know, in the blood it is present in the form of bicarbonate. Bicarbonate play an important role in buffering of the blood. So we can use the bicarbonate as buffering agent. It is less toxic. Balanced salt solution actually provide the inorganic nutrients. It also maintains the pH osmolarity. It also maintains the inorganic it provides inorganic ions to the culture. So basal salt solution can be supplemented with various nutrients to promote the proliferation of cells in culture. In previous time, they were used as basal salt solution with various nutrients are used in as media. But nowadays, various type of media have been discovered. So Eagle was a pioneer in media formulation. He determined the nutrients requirement for mammalian cell culture. Many developments in media preparation have occurred since then. There are more than a dozen media now available for different type of culture, and some of them are listed below. You can see them, like EMEM, Eagle's Minimal Essential Medium, DMEM, Delbacco's modification of Eagle's medium, GMEM, that is the glass gauze modification of Eagle's medium. So the complete media in general contain a large number of components like amino acids, vitamins, salt, glucose, other organic supplements, growth factors, hormones, antibiotics, besides serum. So these are the components. But in the serum-free media, in serum, these nutrients are already available. But in serum-free media, we have to provide them in high amount. And amino acids like essential amino acids should be provided that the cells cannot synthesize. Vitamins should be provided with the high quantity. In the case of the serum-free media, salts are also required to maintain the osmolarity, viscosity, pH. Glucose is also important. It is act as a source of energy. It's act as a source of carbon source. The organic supplements like peptides, nucleic acids, are also important. Growth factors like platelet differentiation growth factor, growth hormones, growth factor related to differentiation of the fibroblast also are important, like fibroblast growth factor, epidermal growth factor, vascular endothelial growth factor, etc. So depending on the medium, quality and quantity of the ingredients can vary. So this is the general procedure for cell culture. So first of all, selection and isolation of the organ take place. And after that, we dissect and remove the nicotic and the fast cell, fat cells. Then we carried out the mechanical disaggregation, or we can carry out the enzymatic disaggregation. And also we can use the primary explant technique to produce the explant that can further give rise to the culture. Now the mechanical disaggregation and the enzymatic disaggregation. Mechanical disaggregation can take place by the chopping, slicing, sieving, syringing, pipetting, etc. In enzymatic disaggregation, various type of enzymes like trypsin, collagenase and other enzymes like bacterial proteases can be used, and then the cells can be disaggregated and then they are resuspended and seeded to form primary culture. After the primary culture, the subculturing of the primary culture give rise to the cell lines. Subculturing of the primary cultures finally give rise to the cell lines. Okay, with the help of cell line, we can choose the particular cell line to form the cell lineages, and after the cell lineages, we can get the cell strain. And we can use them in various purposes, desired to generate our desired products, or to get the cells for transplantation, etc. Cell transfer. Cell transfer is a subculturing of the cells. That refers to the transfer of cells from one culture vessel to the another culture vessel. That is very important. That is very important in culturing of the cells, as we know that the cells in which we are growing the medium. sorry for the disturbance. Where I am, I think I was discussing about the subculture. So subculture usually involves the subdivision of proliferating cells that enables the propagation of a cell line. Okay, the term passage number is used to indicate the number of times a culture has been subcultured. For the proliferating cells, medium need to be changed more frequently, as the proliferating cells consume the medium more frequently than the others. So they require subculturing more frequently. Purpose of subculture. First, we have discussed that we need the fresh medium, we need the space. Confluence is the term that we will discuss later, is used for the cells have already consumed the substrate and the space. So confluency can increase in the case of culturing. So we need subculture to overcome that condition. So purpose of subculture is also to get the specialized cells for specialized purpose. As we know that subculture lead to the cell line, cell line lead to the cell lineages lead to the cell strain. From that we can grow the particular desired product. So for this purpose, subculturing is required, and the one we have discussed for fresh medium, for space, cell lines. Now we will discuss the cell lines. Cell line refers to the propagation of culture after the first subculture. In other words, once the primary culture is subculture, it becomes a cell line. So a given cell line contains several cell lineages of either similar or distinct phenotypes. Okay. Then the cell strains. It is possible to select a particular cell lineage. We can select a particular cell lineage by cloning or physical cell separation or some other selection method, and we can just the cell line derived by selection or cloning is referred to a cell strain. Now the cell strain do not have infinite life, but this is because the cell line can die after some division, because the loss of the capacity of cell renewal after some divisions, because cell strain can develop into particular precursor cells. So they have infinite life, as they die do not have infinite life, and they die after some division. Confluence is the term is used when the cultured cell make close contact with one another, so that the space is fully utilized and the substrate is also utilized in this condition. So in the condition of the confluence, we need subculturing. Cell characterization. Characterization of cultured cell is very important, so we can disseminate the information about the particular cell line from the cell banks. Characterization of the cell line with a special reference to the following aspect is generally done by the morphology of cell, species of origin of the cells, tissue of origin, whether the cell line is transformed or not, identification of specific cell lines, etc. So these are the points from which we can characterize the cells. So we will discuss these points in detail. Morphology of cells. In tissue culture laboratories, the term fibroblastic and epithelial cells are commonly used to identify the fibroblastic-like cells and epithelial-like cells. Fibroblastic cells have the length usually more than twice the breadth. So we can say in the fibroblastic cells that the width is very small, the length is twice of it. So these are fibroblast-like cells, and epithelial-like cells have regular dimension, are polygonal in nature, and they usually grow in monolayers. So this type of cells can be regarded as epithelial-like cells. But if the cells do not recognize both the fibroblast and epithelial-like cells, we can term them the fibroblastoid and epithelioid. Okay. Next is the species of origin of cells. How can we determine the species? By the help of identification with the help of chromosome analysis or electrophoresis of isoenzyme. Or we can use these both by the combination. So we can just we can just extract the cell, then we have to fix the cell on the slide, and then after splitting the cell and fixing the cell on the slide, we can just use the, we can digest it with trypsin enzyme, and we can analyze the metaphase spread. We can analyze the metaphase condition in those cells, and the karyotype can be read. So we can determine the long chromosome, short chromosome or sex, our sex chromosome, and the long chromosome or the autosomal chromosome. So we can determine these chromosomal structure and determine the species with the help of these information. Next is the identification of tissue of origin. Identification of tissue of origin can be determined various by determining the lineages and by the status of cell, like they are stem cells or they are precursor cells. Stem cells are those which keep on dividing, that have a self-renewal capacity, can give rise to the specific various type of cells. Stem cells have the self-renewal capacity, but the precursor cell have lost the self-renewal capacity and can differentiate into a particular type of cells. These are the precursor cells. So we can determine by both of these factors, and various type of tissue marker are used in this case, like differentiate product can be used as a tissue marker, and we can say like differentiate products can be used, and different type of enzymes can also be used in this case. So like, for example, differentiated product like albumin used for hepatocytes, determine the hepatocytes origin. Melanin can be used for melanocytes. Hemoglobin can be used for erythroid cells. And enzymes like tyrosine aminotransferase is specific for hepatocytes. And tyrosinase is specific for melanocytes. Keratin kinase in serum serve as a marker for muscle cells. So we can determine the origin of tissue with the help of these tissue markers. And next one is a transformed cell. So transformation is the phenomenon of the change in the phenotype due to the acquirement of new genetic material. The transformation is associated with promotion of genetic instability. The transformed and the cultured cell exhibit alteration in many characters with reference to the growth rate, mode of growth, longevity, tumorigenicity, specialized product formation. So we can determine with these factors whether the cell is transformed or not. Transformation arises due to the genetic instability. So we can determine the particular particular cells is derived of. For example, we are using the mixed culture, okay, in which various type of cells are present. If some cells are transformed, then we can determine that from which tissue we are getting transformed cells. We can determine, for example, in the case of tumor cells, like some cells can give rise to continuous cell lines. So we can determine that maybe it is originated from the tumor cells. That's why they are giving the continuous cells line. So these are the factors which are required for the culturing of the cells, and after the culturing we get the cell lines, and by these factors we can determine that the cells are transformed or not, like chromosomal instability, like phenotypic characteristic of morphology can be determined, they are pluripotent or not. It can also be determined epigenetic changes are those which are occurred due to the environmental changes. So that can also be governed. Tumor cells can give rise to the specific continuous cell line that can also be determined. So some cells also lost the capacity of self-renewal, so that can also be an indication of transformation. Next is the identification of a specific cell line. So for the identification of a specific cell line, we can do the chromosome analysis, we can detect the DNA, we can detect the RNA protein analysis, we can carry out the RNA protein analysis, enzyme activities can be determined, antigenic marker can be used for this purpose, DNA detection can be done by southern blotting, and RNA protein analysis can be done by northern blotting. Sometimes protein analysis can be done by various type of technique like SDS page and etc. Enzyme activities can be determined with the help of this utilization of a specific substrate. Antigenic marker can be used tetracycline marker and other markers. Various type of markers are available. They can be used for determining the specific cell line. Genetic engineering of cells. So we know that we can introduce the gene into the cell so that we can produce a specific protein that means the desired protein that we require. So there are different type of method involved in introduce the foreign DNA into the mammalian cell. First one is the electroporation. It is a technique in which the electric field are provided to the cell from which the pores are created in the cell, and the DNA transient pores, that is they are created for a small time and then they will recover. So transient pores are created from which the DNA can enter the cell. In liposuction, what happened in liposuction? A lipid molecule is used to encapsulated the DNA. As we know, DNA is a negatively charged and a lipid is positively charged, so they can easily encapsulated. The DNA can easily encapsulate in the lipid, and the lipid can easily, as we know, the cell membrane is made up of lipid, and so the lipid can be easily fuse into the cell membrane, and it can reach to the cell and then to the nucleus. Microinjection is a direct injection of the DNA into the, with the help of the fine needle and the pipette, we can directly inject the DNA into the nucleus. Fusion of mammalian cell with bacteria or viruses. Viruses can be used to inject the particular type of DNA into the cell. Bioelastic or the gun bombardment particle bombardment method can be used, in which the DNA is coated on the gold or silver, and these gold particle can be accelerated with the help of the helium gas, and can be accelerated with the high speed, with the high speed, and we can shoot them up with the help of the gun direct to the DNA. These type of methods are used for injecting this DNA into the cells. So as the foreign DNA gets integrated in the mammalian cellular genome, the gene expression can be expressed to produce the desired protein. So after the desired protein is produced, we need to select them. We can use very selectable marker for selecting these recombinant cells like thymidine kinase, dihydrofolate reductase, bacterial neomycin phosphotransferase. These type of selectable marker can be used to select them, and then the specific genetic engineering product can be obtained. So this technique has led to the revolution in the medical sector. So various type of monoclonal antibodies can be produced by these techniques, which have various wide range of applications, and in treatment, diagnostic, it is also used in drug delivery processes. So there are many type of applications of this cell culture technique. Genetic engineering of cells can also help in near future to combat various type of diseases. These are the references which I have used. Thank you. That is all from my side. I want to repeat it that if you want to suggest me any topic, you can also comment in my comment box. And if you like this video, you can subscribe my channel. You can hit the like button. Thank you.